Enzo Maresca, the new Chelsea manager who you might not know much about. Why have they chosen him? What tactics will he bring to the table? And what does this mean for Chelsea going forward? As a Leicester fan who has been watching him closely for the last year, I hope to provide an insight on those questions today. Maresca started his managerial work with the Manchester City under-23s, utilising a couple of current Chelsea players in Lavia and Cole Palmer. He proceeded to leave the City elite development squad to ply his trade in Italy, his home nation, where he managed Parma, and things didn't go quite to plan, and his win percentage was not ideal. Maresca returned to Man City to be one of Pep's main assistants during their historic treble winning season, certainly picking up tactical nous as he did so. Fast forward to the summer of 2023, and Maresca joined Leicester City to become their new head coach. The target was simple: take the club back to the Premier League whilst implementing his Guardiola-esque playing style. And he succeeded in that task, as Leicester became champions of the Championship and bounced straight back up to the Premier League. A short managerial career, but one of high interest that now leads him getting a 5-year contract as the new Chelsea boss. So why did they choose him ahead of their other target? All the reports were talking about Chelsea wanting a possession-based coach that was young and ready to take on their big project. Maresca ticks all of their boxes. So after a year of watching my team get managed by Maresca week in, week out, let me tell all of you Chelsea fans out there what you can expect to see this upcoming season. Maresca uses a system nearly identical to what we saw at Man City in their treble winning season, so clearly taking a lot of inspiration from Pep. The team's shape starts defensively as a 4 at the back with 3 in midfield and a 3 up front. But as soon as the team gains possession, everything changes completely. We see one of the fullbacks moving into midfield, and it creates this box shape where you have 2 attacking midfielders, and now you are left with 3 at the back defensively. You also have wingers that stay very, very tight to the touchline. And if you have possession and you're moving into the opponent's half, then your striker will be in and around the edge of the box, your wingers will be as wide as they possibly can be, and your 2 attacking midfielders now try and provide options, whilst the fullback that is inverted and your pure number 6 are helping out there. The ball will be held as long as is deemed necessary, and the defenders will try to bait a press from the opposition. As soon as this happens, the transitions can begin. Utilizing the wide center backs or the midfielders, the ball can then be played past the first line of the press. And then ideally the ball is moved upfield toward one of the more forward-thinking midfielders, and the wingers stay as wide as possible in case the ball is played to them. Having the wingers so wide on either touchline ideally means that they only have one defender to worry about, as the ball could get sprayed from the left center back all the way out to the right winger, or to the left winger, so the opposition team can't overcommit on one side. You will therefore see, if the ball does go out to a winger, a lot of underlapping runs from these forward midfielders, taking out the defenders so that the winger still only has one man to beat. So for us last season, if the ball had ended up on the right-hand side with Fatawu, then we would see someone like Wilfred Ndidi make a run inside here, so that either the ball can get played round the defender into the feet of Ndidi, or we will then see Fatawu dribble inside and potentially have a shot at goal. So for us last season, we relied on a few players specifically that are key to this system. The first one being the goalkeeper. They are basically an extra man in attack. And you'll see Mads Hermansen, who played for us, or Stolarczyk in the cup, sometimes coming all the way up here to provide an extra option if the ball needs to go backwards. But the key thing is they need to be fantastic with their feet, because so much of what you do as an Enzo Maresca team relies on your defenders and goalie being able to start attacks in a snap. So goalkeeper is key, and also your centre-backs need to be good at passing the ball. We heavily featured Yannick Vestergaard last season, who had been an outcast at the club under Brendan Rodgers, but Maresca saw the incredible passing range of Vestergaard and saw that he could actually fire a pass all the way out to a winger, or maybe through the lines into one of the attacking midfielders, even through to the striker, due to the movement of the midfield. And you would even see similar from Hermansen in goal. There might be a time where the defensive line is pushed a bit higher, and you would see Dewsbury Hall making a run through, and Hermanson would just do a big lob ball all the way through to him. You also need that inverted fullback. So for us, Ricardo Pereira was phenomenal last season. And when it was four at the back, he started from right back and inverted into this midfield six kind of position. Very, very key that they are great on the ball and forward thinking. Because your job in a Maresca midfield in this position is to receive the ball a lot, instantly turn, and look forward. So Ricardo Pereira and Harry Winks were pivotal in these positions. Winks's role all season was receive the ball off of the defenders, turn, and can he find a winger? Can he find a forward player to ping the ball into? And if not, if the ball comes into him and he can't do anything, then we'll recycle. We'll go back to one of the centre-backs. We'll go all the way across. You will see a lot of sideways and backwards movements between all of these five until someone picks out that key pass all the way forward. So long passing range is vital in this system. So you also need those attacking midfield options that will be able to make runs to help out the wingers, but also contribute massively in terms of goals. So we had the star of the show, Dewsbury Hall, running the midfield from that position. He was the one getting a load of goals and assists because the ball would be played into him from our forwards or from our deeper midfielders, and he would be able to drive and utilize the runs of everybody else in order to create goal scoring chances. We also had wingers that Maresca loved. His ideology for a winger is someone that will stay very, very wide but be very direct. He wants a winger that can run at their fullback and beat a man. So to go from someone like Harvey Barnes, who would never run past his man under Brendan Rodgers, to Steffi Mavadidi and Abdul Fatawu, getting multiple take-ons every game with skills and trickery and flair, was fantastic to watch. So how is this going to work with Chelsea? Here's what I think their lineup could or should be before any signings are made. So bear with me, as this might look a little bit crazy. But this is the kind of lineup that I think you would expect if no signings were made this summer. And let's go through why. So Petrovic was better than Sanchez. I don't think either goalie is good enough with their feet for this system, so we'll just go with the one that was better last year. Colwill has played a mixture of left back and centre back, and so I think he's really, really going to fit this role of the fast Callum Doyle, James Justin-esque role from last season. Fofana, if back from injury, would be great for this system. Passing range, forward thinking, physical and fast. And then the other centre back, I'm honestly not sure. Maybe De Sassi, Badiashile, I don't know. It could be basically anyone. Now, Caicedo at right back might seem a little bit crazy, but he played there at Brighton. And you'll see with the transition into attack how this will make a bit more sense. Lavia in the midfield, assuming that he's fit as the more defensive, receive the ball and play it forward option. With Enzo going further forward, Palmer running through the middle, creating so, so many chances. Wide players of Mudryk and Madueka, because they're probably the most direct wingers that Chelsea have. And Nkunku up front. So let's see how it would transition in attack. So I think Chelsea will be looking something like this. Colwill as that left-sided centre-back, with Fofana in the middle with the most pace and ridiculously good passing range. He can be the one firing the balls through the lines, trying to find the forward-thinking midfielders. And then your other centre-back on this side can do the same. Get it out to the wide man and let something happen. Caicedo would be seen going from this right-back position into midfield. Now, we saw last season Ricardo Pereira fit this role to an absolute T, and it feels like Caicedo is good enough defensively and also good enough on the ball to be able to make this transition and then free players like Palmer and Enzo going forward. To complete the box midfield, it feels like Palmer fits this role perfectly, and Enzo can also play that role where he is making the runs forward, assisting the wingers, and potentially getting long shots off at goal. It feels like the most direct players that Chelsea could utilize right now are potentially Madueka, who loves to get at his man, try and do a bit of a trick and beat them and cut inside. And maybe Mudryk on the other side as well, doing the same thing. I went with Nkunku up front because it feels like the link-up play of the striker is something that can be really utilised, especially when this kind of Maresca system is in full flow state. If you have someone like Palmer giving the ball to Nkunku, making a run himself round a defender and receiving it back, Nkunku would fit that role better than Nicholas Jackson. However, there is also a potentiality where Enzo is one of these deep-lying sixes and Lavia is a bench player and maybe Nkunku goes down here and then you do have Jackson up front and Nkunku and Palmer are the ones making the runs in behind. I feel like there is a bit of versatility there with the players that Chelsea have. So are there any big key differences between what we tried to utilise last season and what Chelsea have in their squad? You could potentially say that transitional fullback if they don't utilise Caicedo in that hybrid role that he sometimes had at Brighton. Because Gusto, Reece James, Chilwell, Cucurella, could any of them fit that role that well? I'm not really sure. They more have marauding fullbacks that do not fit the system at all. We actually loaned out one of our better left backs because he simply didn't want to play this role and it didn't fit him. So there could be a defensive clear out at Chelsea to help fix this scenario. There are rumours surrounding Chelsea targeting players like Elise and Somerville. They would be amazing for this system because they are so direct and attacking. But the biggest problem for Chelsea right now is the goalkeeper. Simply put, they don't have a goalie that is good enough with their feet to fit this system. You could maybe say Kepa coming back from his loan would be the best option they have, but we'll have to see what Enzo thinks once he joins. Now, my hope as a Leicester fan is that there is a sort of clause with him going to Chelsea that they are not allowed to poach any of our players. Otherwise, Chelsea fans, you will be signing Mads Hermansen because he is literally the dream for Enzo. I have personally said I think he'll be playing for Liverpool or Man City within the next 5 years, because he is so good at playing out with his feet and he's an amazing shot stopper. So if you are allowed to poach any of our players, Hermansen is gonna be him. But I'm really intrigued to see how quickly Maresca can implement his style and his tactics onto this sort of disjointed previously Chelsea squad. And so to summarize, my final points are patience is needed. Now we saw when Arteta went to Arsenal, they finished eighth back-to-back years, but they were building a project, they were utilising what he wanted to try and build going forward. However, Maresca seems to have joined a club where they won't allow him to have as much say on transfers, players being kept, players being sold, which is the reason why Poch ended up leaving. So that might be a bit problematic. But the fans will need patience. There will be times where you are going to see the ball played between the goalie, the defender, the six, back to the other one, back to another defender, here, goalie, here, sideways, sideways, backwards, forwards, backwards again. It will be tedious. But the hope for you is that with higher quality players, the transitions from these sideways passes, there won't be as many of them. You will fire it from Colwill into Enzo, and then he'll see this ball out to Madueke. He puts in a cross, and bang, it's in the back of the net. Just free-flowing attacking football with this box shape in midfield is Maresca's dream scenario. We just didn't quite have that quality in order to do so. One thing he also would like is a slightly more physical one of these two forwards, one of the number eight. That is one where I think Chelsea might be lacking. Unless you push Caicedo further forward, he might look for a player that fits that more bulky aesthetic. We used Ndidi there, and when we first saw him in preseason, it seemed baffling. But with the way that he transitioned him throughout the season, it made a lot of sense. So you've got to be patient with everything, and so do the board, because it might take a while. Which is why one of my final thoughts is that it's a bizarre decision from Maresca himself, but also Chelsea. Because whilst he did okay with us, we nearly crumbled a massive, massive points lead that we grew to in the season because there was no plan B, the substitutions were weird. It was basically use the same tactic for the entire game regardless of whether it was working or not. There were times where the ball just never got played out to the wingers, even though they were in acres of space. It would just go sideways, and it was very infuriating. So will the Chelsea board and the Chelsea fans have the patience to wait for things to properly click? I don't know. Which is why I think signing Enzo Maresca as the Chelsea manager is not a bad idea, but only if you are going to give him time and patience and utilize this 5-year contract that they're giving him. To me, that's crazy. He's completely and utterly unproven, and we don't know how he's going to do in the Premier League. I mean, there's a chance that he just gets sacked in 12 months and gets a massive payday, even if it doesn't work out for him here. But giving him 5 years is madness. Because whilst you do want this project manager, you don't know whether the timing and everything is going to be right. He could potentially have you in 17th place next season. Are you really going to keep him for the next 4 years after that? Surely you give a shorter contract, and if things are looking good and progressive, then you give him the bumper contract after the first year or two. But did he jump ship as we are starting next season with a points deduction? We might not be able to sign players. Or was the opportunity too good to turn down? Maybe a bit of both. But give him time, and I imagine that he will succeed. However, if the next footballing transition in terms of tactics moves away from inverted fullbacks, there isn't evidence and precedent and proof of him being able to utilize any different systems. We did the same thing the entire year, regardless of whether it was working or not. So that is a slight worry, but you would imagine he would grow as a manager and maybe tactically try things out, tweak things, maybe in cup games and lesser Premier League teams. But I'm very, very intrigued to see how Enzo does. I don't have that much, like, bad to say about the guy. It's a shame that he's leaving so early, but there were flaws in what he did with us. So will he improve on them? Will he improve Chelsea? We'll have to wait and see. Hopefully you enjoyed the video, though. Loads more like this to come in the future. Thank you very much for watching. Goodbye. Woo!